Listen, what we do is we don't do what the modern dictates of Christianity prescribe.
Amen.
What we do is we give ourselves over to something called joy and rejoicing in the Holy Ghost. We give ourselves over to something called praise and thanksgiving. Now, and we do it on, we don't do it on a stoic level. We don't do it on a European level, a Western level. We do it on a heavenly level. Where out of our innermost being, out of our belly, gushes forth unlimited divine expressions of worship and praise to Almighty God. Now, let me tell you what happened among some people. They left out 1 Corinthians chapter 14 when Paul says, what should we do then?
Yeah.
What should we do then? After trying to lay out an understanding of what worship was supposed to look like, because the church at Corinth learned all their bad habits from Paul anyway, seeing he started that church and was the apostle of it. He said, what should we do then? He said, we will pray in the Spirit.
Yeah.
And he already described what praying in the Spirit. He said, he that speaketh in the unknown tongue speaks not unto man, but unto God. Howbeit, he speaks mystery in the Spirit. And he already made it very clear. This is not some prayer language to hide away in some closet. This is the gushing force, that which Father desires to see man worship him in spirit and truth with. God the Holy Ghost, is the spirit of worship. God the Holy Ghost is the truth. And there's nothing going to change till somebody's not ashamed of the one who's come and overwhelmed our lives and flooded our souls with the testimony of Jesus. There's no way to know anything about God but by the Holy Ghost. There's no way to interact with Father but by the Holy Ghost. There's access into heaven by the Spirit. There's no way to know Jesus but by the Holy Ghost. Jesus said, I'm going to go away and I'm going to send another one to you just like me. He's going to lead you and guide you. You're going to be his servants. You're going to come under his control. Uh-oh. What should we do then? We was praying in the Spirit and we would pray with the understanding also we're going to sing in the Spirit. Well, so then you're going to have to get raptured out into a realm of divine glory to begin to sing in the Spirit. Because it can't be the thing that you learn in your charismatic meeting. It's got to be something that heaven, where heaven came down and touched you and God the Holy Ghost began to express through you. Thing, a praise, a worship, an adoration for Jesus that goes way beyond any human understanding, any human knowledge. And out of this place, this is where we live in divine health. I was telling some people this morning, you want to live in divine health? I live in divine health. I pressed in for that realm. And I live in that divine realm because I participate with the Holy Ghost. We just want to teach. We're not here to convince you to come back. God's not in a popularity contest. We're here to give ourselves over to the ministry of the Holy Ghost to teach you how to live in a place called heaven, in a realm called the Holy Ghost. As many as are led by the Spirit, walk in the Spirit, and live by the Spirit. That's pretty much control. Those who are the temples of the living God, the Holy Ghost lives and dwells in us. You know, some people think, well, look, I'd rather just have God come grab a hold of my hand. Just God come grab a hold of my hand, take me by the hand and lead me. Huh? Oh, I'd feel comfortable. No, Papa said, I got something better for you than that. Uh-huh. I'm going to walk in you.
Amen.
I'm going to see through your eyes, touch through your hands, walk through your feet. Yeah. We just want people to experience that. Because there's not an earthly thing. There's not an earthly dimension in that realm. But it is joy unspeakable and full of glory. It's not something to just consider. It's not fictional Christianity. It's the literal and real, genuine thing. Receive right now. Receive pratase. Receive right now. Right out of your belly flows. Maybe there's somebody here today, you don't know Jesus Christ. Right now, the Holy Spirit is here to introduce him to you, and you can receive a new heart and a new spirit and be baptized in his glory all at the same time. All you got to do is really want him. Father's not interested in people who want to continue on in sin. He's looking for folks who want to get delivered out of it. Father's not interested in those who want to associate with the world and with the things of demon spirits. He's looking for people who want to be set free from a prison. And today we tell you in the name of Jesus Christ, we set you free from your prison.
Yeah.
In Jesus' name, whatever it may be, or whatever limits it may have placed upon your life. Some people have never come to know the peace that passes understanding. You know what that peace is? It's a place where there is no condemnation. Peace is the absence of condemnation. That's why I said, those who are near and those who are far away, come on in. Wow. And then he says, listen, come here, abide with me. I'll teach you how to walk this way. And if need be, this is incomprehensible that the holy, holy, holy God would do this. If need be, I'll forgive you 490 times in a day for sins and transgression and treason against the kingdom. Treason. Something far worse than Adam did. I'll forgive you 490 times in a day, but there is a condition. You got to forgive others. Huh? That's coming under the authority of mercy, which only flows out of love. You don't have mercy without love. Man, you don't have forgiveness without mercy. We want everybody to enjoy this fellowship here today. Hallelujah. Karabasiki ananakateya. Mambambra babata baraneya. Ibridevetususi. Jesus, we love you. Hora mama makata seteya. Eres te perunamba sepekelolobo. Irevatana neya shepekielolobo. Hallelujah. 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 Today, we want you to understand we are Pentecostals. This is a Pentecostal church. Pentecostal doesn't mean the 50th day to me. Something far more than that. It means the voice, the audible voice. It was the day that the audible voice was heard from Mount Sinai, Exodus chapter 19. It was the day the audible voice was heard from the belly of those who had been redeemed, Acts chapter 2. The people want to just intellectualize the workings of God. You'll never intellectualize. Father's not interested in your mental affirmation. He wants the kisses and he wants the hugs that are real. He wants the kisses, the hugs. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Son, I want you to sing one more worship song. All. Sing the song, All That I Have Need Of, I Find In You. I'm At The Cross I See. Are you with me? Do that one. Let's just do this.
Every day I see.
Every day.
Would Christ He did for me.
Yeah.
And every day receive
His love for me. On the cross he gave.
Oh, upon the cross he gave.
Come on now, a little faster.
All that I'll ever need.
Hallelujah.
When he rose up from the grave in victory. When he rose up from victory.
Yes, every day I see what Christ He did for me.
Hallelujah.
And every day,
hallelujah,
we see
His love for me.
For upon the cross,
He gave all that He had.
When He rose up from the grave, His victory.
Just tell Jesus how much you love Him.
Oh, we love you, Jesus.
Just tell Him how much you love Him.
Love you, Lord. Love you, Jesus.
Just join with us as we tell Him how much we love Him. Jesus, we love You. Hallelujah. Jesus, we worship You. Hallelujah. Holy, 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 holy is the Lord. Jesus, we worship You. Hallelujah. Lord, we adore You. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Well, we're so blessed to have all of you here, and we want you to be overwhelmed with the presence of Jesus. All we desire, we really don't desire to do anything but to communicate to you this wonderful gospel, this wonderful good news, where you can begin to experience the very life that Father has Himself lives and provided for us in Jesus. We live in this glory realm and every day of our lives, and this is the place right here in the context of His church where you get introduced, and hopefully where you begin to become developed and matured into the things of yielding to the Holy Spirit and walking with Him, moving with Him. Hallelujah. You can be seated. We're blessed, we're very blessed today to have Joel Stockstill and his wife Amy with us. And of course, Joel comes from a great, great family. His daddy's a preacher, grandpapa's a preacher. Mama is daughter of a great man of God as well. So just a great heritage, a rich heritage. And he's Pentecostal.
Yeah.
And he believes in the audible voice and reaching in to have the very expressions of heaven. Father, we so desire Your glory and the manifestation of Your presence in every person's life, that no longer would people be stuck within the frameworks of a ritual, a knowledge of You without an understanding, a knowledge, O God, without the very experience of Your presence and interaction with You, Father. For we know You've called us into a relationship of oneness. Lord, You've not wanted us to come just observe and look upon You from a distance, but to come sit with You in a place called the heavenly realm. Father, You see right here at this very moment the things that are going on in people's lives that have caused them heartache and pain and turmoil and distress. You see the things that have caused people distractions and discouragements. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that they would be strengthened by Your Spirit right now to where those things don't even matter anymore. They're so detached from all that stuff that all the, there's one desire, and that is to walk with you, to know you, to interact with you. Father, we pray right now in Jesus' name for the floodgates of heaven to overwhelm every hungry heart and every thirsty soul.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Robo sukitalaya. Kirimanjale katai. Hallelujah. Mambro. Just some of you still staring at me. I just want you to worship him. I want you to worship him. I want you to just worship him. Just worship him.
Yeah. We worship.
Hallelujah. Worship him. This is his house where the manifestation of his spirit is given to every single person. You don't have to do anything other than just receive. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Sikambro vatura de de le pekias. Arama mamba brebete. Arama mamba barustoro mankideo. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, worship wasn't in any way defined by music in the early days, in the early biblical expression. Worship rather was defined by this activity of interacting with Father through an offering that we bring, an offering that represents Jesus. And you know, I'm just overwhelmed right now. I'm just a little bit overwhelmed with the person Christ Jesus. He goes beyond all that I can comprehend and all that I can imagine. How that he can love us so much. Today, I pray that you come to a living, relational understanding of who he is, because you're living in perilous times and people don't realize how perilous they are. And I so desire every person in this place to be born of the Spirit, to receive the life of Jesus. And sometimes we get to this point and I don't even want to go on. I don't want to wait to the end of the meeting. Not when I sense that people have been holding things back from the Lord and living their own life. We believe that the majority of the church today that calls themselves the Christian church, we believe that the majority of them need to get saved and receive the life of Jesus. We believe this. We believe in the washing of the water of regeneration, renewing of the Holy Ghost. And when it happens, you don't have to have somebody hovering over top of you, continually telling you what's right. Because the Holy Ghost will teach you. You don't have to have somebody calling you up saying, don't you remember you need to be in the meeting. You need to be under the anointing. Because all you have is heaven in your heart. And a desire, one desire. I want everybody in this place. I want everyone in this place right now. I want you to lift. I don't want you necessarily to bow your heads. But I want you to lift your heart towards heaven and surrender to him and just begin to let Father know that you want him to be first in your life and you ask him forgiveness. Say, Lord, I'm sorry for making you second and third and fourth and prioritizing you. Lord, I want you to be first. I want to know you in the way to where that you first and foremost in my life. Right now, in Jesus' name, if there's anything holding anybody back, anything hindering anyone right now, in the name of Jesus Christ, it's removed out of the way. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Listen to this. In times past, they would come with a lamb or with a goat or with another sacrificial animal to be able to interact with Father. Today, we get to look through the veil of Jesus. We get to look through the veil of the flesh of Jesus Christ and behold Father in the holies of holies. We get to, through the veil of the flesh of Christ Jesus, we get to look in and stare at the holiness of God, the beauty of God, and cry, holy, holy, holy. We want you to do this, and I want you to do this. I'm in earnest about moving the church past the ritual of Sunday morning into a place of an encounter with God.
Yes.
That makes a difference on Monday morning. That makes a difference. That causes you to say, look, I don't even want to leave the meeting. When we're in China, people don't even want to leave the meeting. I try to get them to go to lunch. They just say, well, the presence of the Lord Jesus is too sweet right now. We're just going to stay. You can go eat lunch. We'll be waiting for you when you get back. Would you pray with me and believe God to show us what hinders revival? What hinders the move of God? How that great leaders, supposedly great leaders in monstrous churches, can stand on the side of sin and iniquity and tell God we're not going to be under your law? Huh? Think about it. And many of them write the songs that you sing. I tell you, people just need to get back to basics, heart to heart, just loving on the Lord Jesus. The Lord's not impressed with our adjectives anyways. He's interested in us getting a song copyrighted. He just wants a heart. He wants the affections of a heart. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Mm-mm-mm. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Ha ha. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your loving kindness and your tender mercies. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, living God. Thank you, living God. Father, we thank you that today we can make a difference in this meeting. We can lift up our voice and cry out to you until you ultimately respond in a way that goes beyond anything that man can do. And suddenly Southern California is shaken by your glory and by your power, because there's a people who truly, genuinely desire the outpouring of your glory that arrests the hearts of men. Father, I pray that everyone would make this a moment in time of intercession, a moment in time of crying out to you, God, a moment in time, Lord, of letting you know that we truly want you, Father, to come rule and reign. We say, Father, your kingdom come right now. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that there would be abandonment and relentlessness, an abandonment and complete surrender of every person's life to you, and a relentlessness to take a hold of those things, Lord, that you've freely given, so that all that wonderful dimensions of Jesus' ministry, these works and greater works, will be seen in this place. Father, we ask you to forgive us for all the things that we've done that has polluted your holy name. Father, we pray in Jesus' name that the religion of ritual, dead religion, lifeless religion, would not have no place in our lives. But Holy Spirit, you just take complete control of every dimension of this life that we live. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I want to be able to give you an opportunity here before we get started to be able to give an offering to the Lord, but I don't like to even do it until I feel like everybody's heart's already been given over. Because it's not the offering that the Lord wants in terms of your finances. However, he's going to bless your finances if you participate with it in the right way. But it's not your money that he wants, it's your heart.
Amen.
Your father doesn't need any money. The kingdom doesn't even operate on money. What Father wants is he wants your affections and your heart. Will you give it to him? Father wants your deepest desire and deepest longings. The things you want most of all, so much you want it so much that nothing else even matters. You know, I was thinking this morning about Jesus says to Martha, really he's addressing everyone there. He says, roll back the stone. Martha says, wait a minute, he's been dead for 4 days, he stinks. Jesus said, look, didn't I tell you if you just believe, you'd see the glory and the power of God? Jesus made faith so simple right there. All she had to do is be willing to cooperate with the stone being rolled back. He's going to do the rest. God takes the littlest acts of obedience and works the greatest miracles of faith through them. We are engaged in the greatest warfare of all time. We engaged in the battle over men's souls. We engaged in the life of the church and the purposes of God being manifested in His glorious church. While a great conflict goes on within the ranks. And there's only one way that you and I are going to be able to do anything in this realm, is our hearts are going to have to be given over completely to the Spirit of truth. We're going to have to find our way out of the place and the ditch that we're stuck in. We're going to have to find our way out of the lifestyle that we've been living, the realm that we've been justifying. We're going to have to find our way out of that. And today is the perfect opportunity.
Amen.
Today, everything about your heart and your attitude can change right now in a moment, instant, twinkling of an eye. Everything about the crisis in your life, the obstacles that are too big for you to overcome and to defeat, instantly, completely removed out of the way. Whatever prison you've been living in, whether it's sickness or sin or disease or addiction, whatever it is, torment of the mind, harassment of the mind. There are so many people right now on the planet that have mental disease and mental illnesses of various different sorts. And Christ Jesus died for everyone to be set free. The torment of sin, the torment of sickness, the torment of disease, the torment of depression, the torment of heaviness of heart, the torment of men's approval, whatever it may be. Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we set you free. Right now, in the name of Jesus, the things that have held onto your heart, the things that have caused you to hold back from giving it all to Him, completely moved out of the way. Right now, in the name of Jesus, Father, we asking you to glorify your Son, Jesus, in this place. We asking you to reveal the mighty acts of the Holy Ghost right here in this place and through the lives of the people here. Hallelujah. Phew. Phew. I believe this. I believe with all of my heart that when God's people are going to be willing to say, whether we live or whether we die, we're going to do everything that you command us to do. We're going to cross over into the realms of the inheritance. It's already freely given. It's already been given. You just can't live in it without total consecration to the Lord, because He's not sharing His glory, and He's not going to participate in His name being polluted among the nations. It's just true. It's just true. I keep hearing the Lord Jesus saying to me over the past week and a half, come apart into a solitary place with me. I know He's saying it for two reasons. Because one, He wants to do things in my life and show me things that He can't show me when I'm distracted and caught up in all the stuff that's going on in this world and in this life, this present condition that we're in. And two, because Father's about ready to pour out His judgment upon the church. You think he's going to abide this nonsense? You think He's going to abide it? You think he's less stirred than myself or Joel or anyone else? No, He's not. He's stirred. He's stirred. I was reading Fraudstrom's prophecy of the coming deception this morning. That tender young prophet of the Assemblies of God back in the 20s. And we're living in what he prophesied was going to happen. We're living in it. And we just want you guys today, we want you to decide you want heaven. Now.
Amen.
Not just later. Now. Uh-huh. Heaven now. Yes. Heaven is defined by Jesus. See, Jesus is heaven.
Yes.
Most people won't even like heaven, because it's all about Jesus. They don't even want to go. But if you want heaven, heaven's here available to you right now. It's love that passes knowledge. And just staying right here, just think about this. You could step into the love the love of Christ Jesus right now and be filled with all the fullness of God. It's just abiding right there in that realm of love. You step in a peace that passes understanding right now. You can step in to joy unspeakable and full of glory and not just have it as a one-time, short, 15-minute, two-hour experience. But you live in it day in, day out. Come on, man. And you begin to shine as a bright light of His glory. And then, no matter what's going on, if it's sickness, disease, healed instantly, whatever gifts the Spirit's needed, it operates. Hallelujah. Joe, I want you to just come. We're just going to wait till later and see how the Lord just moves, but with respect to the offering. Because the offering for me, the offering is so holy. So holy. It ain't about bills and all that other stuff. Just so holy. So we just kind of want to wait and see what God does with you and all happens here. And we'll take it from there. Jesus.
Hallelujah. Man, the presence of God is here today. That's what matters, isn't it? The presence of God. Well, I am so glad to be here today. I brought my beautiful wife with me, Amy. Amy, would you stand up? Y'all give her a hand. Greet her today. She's having fun playing with Allie and her babies. And I'm going to set this right here. You know, there's a flow of the Spirit here that sadly is very unusual. Sadly. We gladly receive it, but we grieve that it's not everywhere. God has just put something here that's so special, and it's not something that other people can't have. They could be special too, but when you're in this anointing and when you're in the river of God like this, know that you are blessed to be in a house where the presence of God is valued above all else. And just the worship, just, man, that was amazing. Well, I am glad to be here in sunny San Diego. Whenever you get asked to come to San Diego from Louisiana or Texas, you say yes. It doesn't matter what time of year. It doesn't matter what it's for. It's just yes. And yesterday, Amy and I came in, and Pastor Mark took us down to the college that he attended, and we went out on the cliffs looking out over the ocean. And it's just something about when you look at the Pacific Ocean, just the peace of God just overwhelms you, just the bigness of God. You just kind of forget about everything, all your little problems and all your little issues you're dealing with. And sometimes they may be big issues, but when you look at that ocean and you think of the bigness and vastness of God, it just all seems to fade away. Isn't that right? Amen. I want to read a verse of Scripture this morning as we're getting started. I have something on my heart I want to share with you. And many of you are not real familiar with my story and who I am. And today I'd just like to get to know you and you get to know me and what God has done for me and through me. Romans chapter 4, verse 16, I'm going to read a couple of verses of God's word. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. I'm reading out of the New Living Translation. So the promise is received by faith. Somebody say, by faith.
By faith.
It is given as a free gift. Somebody say, it's a free gift. And we are all certain to receive it, whether or not we live according to the law of Moses, if we have faith like Abraham's. So we don't have to live under the law of Moses. But we have to have faith like Abraham's. For Abraham is the father of all who believe. And that is what the scriptures mean when God told him, I have made you the father of many nations. This happened because Abraham believed in the God who brings the dead back to life and who creates new things out of nothing. That's the kind of God we serve. If it's dead, he can bring it back to life. If it doesn't exist, he can make it. I dare Muhammad to try that. Even when there was no reason for hope, Abraham kept hoping, believing he would become the father of many nations. For God had said to him, that's how many descendants you will have. And Abram's faith did not weaken, even though at about 100 years of age, he figured his body was as good as dead, and so was Sarah's womb. She was 10 years younger, 90. Abraham never wavered in believing God's promise. In fact, his faith grew stronger, and in this he brought glory to God. For he was fully convinced that God is able to do whatever he promises. And because of Abraham's faith, God counted him as righteous. When God counted him as righteous, it wasn't just for Abraham's benefit. It was recorded for our benefit too, assuring that God will also count us as righteous if we believe in him, the one who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead. He was handed over to die because of our sins, and he was raised to life to make us right with God. Father, we just thank you today for your word. We thank you, Father, for your spirit. We thank you for the word and the spirit. We thank you for the water of the word and the wine of the spirit today. And Lord, we don't take one and reject the other. We gladly accept both in their proper place, that we might be hydrated, satisfied, overflowing, intoxicated, inebriated with the goodness of your love and your mercy. And Lord, today I just pray as I minister for the next couple of minutes, Lord, that your spirit would be working even as I speak. I pray, Lord, that the spirit of hope in Christ Jesus would come alive in a whole new dimension in the hearts of those who are here, for those who have faced disappointment, for those who are holding on to the promise of God, even if it's as ridiculous as Abraham believing for a son at 100 years of age and Sarah at 90. Lord, I pray that today they would keep hoping, and those who have stopped hoping would begin to hope again, and those who have continued to hope would be encouraged in their hope and strengthened in their hope and more alive in their hope today because of the testimony of Christ Jesus and what he's done in me and through the countless cloud of witnesses that stand in agreement with us concerning the miracle-working power of Almighty God. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. In 2012, the Lord began to speak a word in my spirit that would forever change my life. And that word was the word hope. And I had taught a lot on faith, but I had never taught on hope. And where the journey started was Hebrews 11:1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for. And the Lord began to speak to me about my own life. And in 1995, August 25th, 1995, at 16 years of age, I experienced kidney failure and was placed on dialysis 3 times a week. It was a very very shocking thing that happened for me as a young man. Everything in my life up till then had pretty much been perfect. And then all of a sudden, perfect went to nightmare just like that. Anybody in here ever had something like that happen where it just overnight things turned around? And I was faced with the reality of great hardship, great suffering, and that began a battle over my destiny, over my calling, over my life, over everything about what God wanted to do in me and through me and through my family. And after many years of that battle, 2012, I feel like the Lord began to speak to me and say, you've given up hope. Oh, no, Lord, I'm standing and believing. And, you know, sometimes we get ourselves worked up in what we know, but we're really not standing in faith. And the Holy Spirit just began to show me that hope has to be at the root of faith. And that if you've lost hope, you're not in faith anymore. And I realized that I had begun to lose hope and maybe had lost hope for my situation. And through just year after year and decades and doing over 2,500 dialysis treatments, I think the thing had just pretty much tried to die inside of me. And the Holy Spirit began to minister this word of hope to me. And I felt like the Lord said to me, I want you to do something different than you've done before. Because always preachers preach, there's two ways to preach. There's preach about what you know, and then there's preaching about what you want to know. And there's revelation that you preach from, and there's revelation you preach to. And this has not happened to me, but very rarely and never at this level where the Holy Spirit said, I want you to begin to preach on hope. And I said, Lord, I don't know anything about hope. And he said, that's why I want you to preach on it. And so I began preaching on hope. I didn't know anything about it. I just started preaching about it. And as I began to preach about it, I began to learn about it. And then in January of last year, 2013, I like to read through the whole Bible in the month of January, and I like to pick one theme that I pick up on through the whole Bible, and of course I chose hope. And there's 250 verses on hope in the Bible, directly on hope. And so as I was going through, I wrote out all 250 verses on hope. By the time I got done with that, I had something. I started knowing a little bit about hope. In fact, I preached before I did that at the end in the December of 12 at my home church in Louisiana on hope. And it was a very powerful day. And many people were ministered to. And by a year later, the Lord had showed me so much about hope, it was as if I didn't know anything when I did that. And I preached the same exact message again on hope, and it was like a whole different message. The Lord said, just preach it again. You're in a whole new dimension with it. Preach it again. So I just preached it again. And the Lord began to move on my heart and say, I want you to preach this every Sunday. And I began to preach it every Sunday. Every church that I would go to, I would preach on hope. And something just started happening in me. Something started getting inside of me and coming alive in me. And I began understanding things that God had been orchestrating that I didn't even know or understand what he was orchestrating. And I began to look back and look at all the things that had happened in my life and everything, how God had been orchestrating things up to that point around this message of hope. And being here in San Diego is a reminder. I was here at the end of 2007. My first wife was battling with cancer, and we came here to put her in a clinic in Tijuana. And we were here for a season, and I wasn't able to stay the whole time because I had to go back. I was doing treatments, and she was in Tijuana at a clinic, and in early 2008, she passed away and went to be with the Lord. And after that happened, I sold our home and moved to another house near our church that was on a street called Hope Street. And I didn't think anything about it because I didn't have the revelation of hope. And then in 2009, I began to date this lovely young lady, and her name was Amy Hope. And so in 2010, I married Hope. And being a typical man, I still didn't get it. So I'm living on Hope Street, and I married Amy Hope, and I still didn't know anything about hope. God was trying to tell me something. And I began to get this message in me for the body of Christ, particularly those of us who walk in faith and are still believing God for the promise. You know, there should never be a time in your Christian walk where you're not believing God for the promise. There's never a time where you just arrive and then from then on you're never tested again. In fact, when Abraham received the promise of Isaac, several years later, when Isaac was 12, 13 years old, he said, take Isaac, your only son, and sacrifice him. And he was tested in a whole new dimension. So there's never a time in your Christian walk where you should not be facing some sort of challenge of faith, because without faith, it's impossible to please God. And if you're not believing for anything, you're not pleasing God with anything. You know, I try to stay open to the Holy Spirit at all times to see how he would challenge me and give me opportunity to please Father with my faith. When the Holy Spirit says, you know, one of the most tangible ways that that happens is through giving. Because I don't know about you, but giving is something that challenges me. I can go to a prayer meeting and pray 5 hours and never think anything about it. But when the Holy Spirit taps me on the shoulder and says, hey, give $1,000 to that. So everything in me goes, uh-uh. No. Joel says no. And the Jesus in me says yes. The Holy Ghost says yes. And we have an opportunity to please the Father. I love what you said. The kingdom's not run on money. It's not. God's not sitting in heaven thinking, hey, man, we got some real potholes on Straight Street. We need to get this stuff shored up. Angels, get down there and stir up an offering in the church so we can get some finances flowing up here in heaven and fix these golden streets. I'm afraid we may have to downgrade to silver before long if we don't get another offering. No. God's throne is God's throne, with or without us and our money. But our faith, pleasing him, is what's on the line. Being pleasing unto God. And we're tested. We're tested in many different areas. I use that as an illustration. But I realized that God was wanting to do something in me pertaining to the arena of hope. And I began to press into it. And I began to look in the scriptures. And I after studying those 250 times that word was used in the scriptures and really pressing in, I began to lay hold of something. And as I began to lay hold of that, I found that hope is the pilot light for the flame of faith. And if that pilot light is not lit, then the flame will not burn. And as much teaching as we have on faith, and faith, I love teaching on faith, but hope is literally at the root of faith. Hope in Christ, the hope of heaven, the hope that we have in Jesus of eternal life, the hope that we have in Christ is at the very foundation of all of the faith that we exercise in the kingdom. And God began to just relight that pilot light inside of me through all the battles and all the wars and the scars and everything. I realized the Lord was saying, I'm breathing a fresh hope back into you. And I just believe this morning, as I'm talking, God is breathing a fresh hope back into some of your hearts. Some of you are single and you've lost hope in companionship. And the Lord says, I am able to do exceeding abundant, above all you could ask or think. To go above and beyond. In whatever dimension, when you've logically began to dismiss the possibility of what I promised, I'm still able. The question is, do you still have hope? God is not going to override your hopelessness. I'm going to say that again. God is not going to override your hopelessness. Your hope is the faith he's looking for to intervene in the situation. You know, I was reading this week about the widow in 2 Kings who came to Elisha and said, my sons are going to be taken and sold as slaves, and I don't have the money to pay. And he said, what do you have in your house? She said, I have a flask of oil. He said, go and borrow vessels. Closed the door, began to pour, and when you finished, sell the oil and pay the debt. And you know, she was seemingly almost hopeless in the situation, but she had enough hope. She didn't know how or when or where, but she had enough hope to go and ask the man of God what to do. Right. And that's all she needed. Right. Just that act of humility and faith was all that was needed to turn the whole situation around. She didn't have to go on a 40-day fast to figure out what to do. All she had to do was just go to the man of God and say, I'm helpless, but I'm not hopeless because I'm standing here talking to you. See, helpless and hopeless are not the same thing. We can feel helpless so quickly. I mean, have you ever gotten a bad flu or something and you just thought you were going to die? And then 3 days later, you were back at work. Isn't that funny how your mind and your emotions, they play tricks on you? And Romans 4:18 has been probably the key verse in my life for the last 2 years, that even when there was no reason for hope, Abraham kept hoping, or hoped against hope. So I found that there are certain things we have to understand when we talk about hope. And as I began to think and pray about hope, I said, Lord, I need a picture of something that makes this tangible to me. Show me something, because I'm a seer. I see things, and the Lord shows me things. And I said, Lord, I need a picture. And all of a sudden, I was standing in a black place. It looked like a room. I thought I must be in a pitch black room. And I was standing. And the Lord said, what do you see? I said, I don't see anything. It's pitch black. And then the Lord said, no, look again. What do you see? And as I got acclimated in the room, I saw something in the distance, just a little glimmer. And I said, Lord, I see a glimmer of light. I must not be in a room because it's way off in the distance. And the Lord spoke to me and he said, hope is seeing light at the end of the tunnel when you're standing in the pitch black. When everything around you seems pitch black, yet somehow you still see that there's light. And if there's light, then there's hope, because I can get out. If I just get to that light, it might be a year away, it might be 10 years away, I don't know where it is, but if I can get to that light, I can come out of this darkness. It's light at the end of the tunnel. When you're standing in the pitch black, when your senses say, I'm surrounded by blackness, my spirit says, I see light. So what does that mean? Hope is yielding to what you see in your spirit instead of accepting what you see in your senses. It's yielding to what you see with the eyes of your spirit instead of accepting what you see in the realm of facts. Now, reason and logic are the enemies of hope. Because logically, it's very easy to come very quickly to the place of being hopeless. When the doctor says, sorry, ma'am, you're not going to ever have children. Well, that's a fact. Right there, boom, the lights go out, pitch black. But the Word of God says the barren woman would rejoice, for she who had no children now has more than all the other. And what is this? This is a clash between the facts and the truth. Somebody said, well, the facts and the truth are the same thing. No, they're worlds apart. The facts can be a lie. And the enemy moves in the realm of facts. He cannot move in the realm of truth. And so he tries to eclipse the truth with facts. In 2000, it had been 5 years since I had encountered kidney failure. And in 99, I had a transplant. It didn't work. My health was very, very poor. I was 6'5", 127 pounds. I'd lost almost all my hair. Eyes sunk into my head. It looked like it was over. The doctor's office of my nephrology unit called the kidney doctors. They called in. Me and my mother went to this appointment, and they called in the head of the nephrology clinic, Dr. Kenny, because my family had been known to be sort of cantankerous when it came to receiving medical news. In other words, it was optional to us whether or not we agreed or accepted what they said. Where most people, that's just it. They just accept it, and that's just the way that it is. But we weren't like that, and they didn't like that. And so they thought if we get the head of the clinic in here, it'll carry more weight, and maybe they'll be more apt to accept the reality of the situation. So we sat down, And it was a small office, and Dr. Kinney, who I'd known for several years already and have known since then, and he's a great guy, he just doesn't know the Lord, and he began to say, we just want you to know where you're at with Joel, Miss Stockstill. And we want Joel to know as well. You've got 6 months to live. If you stay in the bed, do your treatments, eat what we tell you, you'll live about 6 months. That's the good news. The bad news is, if you don't, you'll be dead in 6 weeks. When you're 20 years old, you're not wanting to hear, you got 6 months if we do what we tell you, 6 weeks if you don't. That's never the plan. No, nobody ever thinks, hey, I get 20 years on this earth, praise God, that's all I've got. No. And I didn't know the word like I do now, obviously. And I hadn't preached sermons and won people to the Lord and traveled and preached. I'd done any of that. But up out of my spirit came Psalm 118, verse 17. I shall not die, but live and declare the works of the Lord. And while he was still, you know, it's not enough for him to say it. They feel like they got to say it over and over again till you start crying or something. That's how they know you've accepted it. And while he was talking, just, it was an unction, just exploded out of my spirit. I just pointed across the table at him and said, I will not die, but live and declare the works of the Lord. I didn't know where it was in the Bible. I didn't know the exact wording to say that. I just knew that's what came out. And then he started shaking his head like, see, here we go. Here we go. That's why they called me. Here we go. You know, this poor kid, he's just in denial. He's getting this bad news. He's not going to live much longer. And he's just in denial. Well, I was in denial. It wasn't in denial of the truth. It was in denial of the facts. Because the truth contradicted the facts. And because I believe the truth has power. Facts have no power unless you give it to them. And so that was in January of 2000. And not to ruin the suspense, but that diagnosis and prediction, it didn't happen. Joel didn't die. He's here right now. 2014. 2005, go 5 years later. I haven't seen that particular doctor in 5 years because he was the head of the clinic. I had other doctors. And so I was going in once a month for a checkup. And I went in for my checkup, and I was a pastor at this time, associate pastor, and I had my suit on. I had been visiting some other people in the hospital, and the appointment was right by the hospital, so I just ran over to the appointment. I'd been up praying for people in the hospital. Had my suit on. That's back when we wore suits, you know. Had my suit on, went in there, and when I went into the room to wait for the doctor, you know, they want you to sit up on the bed with the paper on it, the crinkly paper. But I didn't want to sit up there. I don't like those things. So I sat over in the chair. And it was over in the corner, and he came in, and there was nobody on the chair. And he turned around and looked back, and I said, Doc, I'm here. And he looked over, and I stood up, shake his hand. I'm wearing a suit, and I shook his hand, and he was looking at me like he had seen a ghost. He said, I don't believe this. Well, it doesn't matter what he believed. There I was. He listened a little bit and fumbled around a little bit and said, well, you seem to be doing well. I don't understand it, but keep doing whatever it is you're doing. I said, don't worry about that. That just meant, hey, keep praying in the Holy Ghost. Keep reading the word every day. Then I was under doctor's orders to keep doing what I was doing. So the truth will eventually bring them around. The facts will never change anything. Facts have no power to change the situation for the good. They can only confirm the negative. But the truth has the power to reverse the facts. Here's Abraham, 100 years old. Sarah's 90. And God says, you're going to have a kid. He's been waiting 25 years. Now, that's a long time. And 100-year-old men don't have babies with 90-year-old women. Now, I want you to see this, something here about this that I love. In verse 20, Abraham never wavered in believing God's promise. In fact, his faith grew stronger, and in this, he brought glory to God. Now listen, there's something about God. God is very smart. Despite what some idiots think, he's very smart. And he knows that when things happen in the realm of natural occurrence, it doesn't bring him any glory. But when things happen completely out of the realm of normal occurrence, it brings him glory. Otherwise, he could have just sent Jesus down here and Jesus could have done some teachings and had some disciples and then gone back to heaven and then they would have done. No, God wanted to show up and show out by having him crucified, buried for 3 days, and resurrected. Why did Jesus wait 4 days for Lazarus? So that the power of God could be seen. And God will choose situations that require great discomfort for us because they're outside of the realm of natural occurrence in order to bring himself great glory. You know, if you've got a cold and you pray and God heals you, that's great, and you can share that with some people, but chances are that's not going to be a book that's going to change people's lives. What if I wrote a book, said the Lord, back in September 2009, the Lord healed me of a cold. It was marvelous. I had had a runny nose for about 24 hours. I even had a slight headache. I received prayer. I was instantly healed, and the world has never been the same since. That would definitely be a New York Times bestseller. No. No, God chooses big things to give big glory to himself. Now, if Abraham had been 35 and Sarah had been 25, this would not have been anything out of the ordinary. It's happened about 7 billion times lately. If you go out there to the Pacific and catch a fish, that's not out of the realm of the ordinary. If you go to a water puddle out in the parking lot and catch a 10-pound bass, that's weird. God didn't just wait till Abram was 75 and Sarah was 65. He waited till they were 190. Abraham was 100, Sarah was 90. And then he said, okay, it's been long enough, it's weird enough now, where they'll still be talking about this. 4,000 years later, we're sitting here in the year of our Lord, 2014, talking about a 100-year-old and a 90-year-old that had a baby. It never happened before, and I don't know how old Zechariah and Elizabeth were, but I don't think it's ever happened since at that quite extreme. Because God wanted to bring great glory to himself through Abraham. And it was very uncomfortable for Abraham. But he didn't know that sitting here 4,000 years later, we'd be in San Diego, California at the Abiding Place Church talking about him and Sarah. And when you're walking through whatever it is that you're walking through and believing God for that the devil is desperately trying to kill your hope for, you don't have any idea the impact that miracle and testimony is going to have on other people. We get so caught up in how it's affecting us right now that we can't see the eternal implications of what the Holy Spirit is orchestrating for the glory of the Father. And so that's where we just have to have hope. We can't reason it out. We'll never figure it out. All we can do is just pray that God would continue to build us up and strengthen us until the moment when he says, roll away the stone. And Martha said, Lord, he stinketh. Or what are you doing? And good thing he didn't listen to Martha. You know, it's probably John was being nice. He left it out of his gospel, but Jesus said, hey, Martha, shut up. I am the resurrection and the life. Be quiet. Martha, don't ruin this. I'm getting ready to do something that's way bigger than you'll ever be. See, I want God to do something through me that's way bigger than anything I'll ever be. And we may have nice warm fuzzies about Abraham, but Abraham's been long gone for about 4,000 years. He would have no impact on us today if it were not for his faith. If his hope had not stayed alive and he had not had Isaac, he would never have fulfilled the plan of God, and thus he would be irrelevant to us today. And, you know, as I began to see my situation in a different light through the lens of hope, I began to see, you know what? I don't like going to these treatments. I went Friday. I went Wednesday. I went Monday. I don't like going to these treatments. I don't like going through this. I don't like the battles. I've had over 70 operations. I've been at death's door over 5 times. I mean, I've seen a lot of things. But you know what? God is going to get great glory out of this situation. And I don't know how it's going to happen, because I'm not going to tell God how he has to move. If it were up to me, I would have told him 20 years ago, Lord, heal me now. But you know what? He's God. And he's not limited to our feelings or our emotions. He could sympathize because Jesus was touched with the infirmities that we all face. But God holds on for the best and not for the easy. And today, I believe that there are some of you, you're like Abraham was at 99 years old. You've been believing for that son, that daughter, that grandchild. You've been believing for whatever it is in your life to get out of debt, come out of poverty. I don't know what it is that you've been believing and holding on. Maybe it is a sickness in your body you've been battling against, and you've been fighting the good fight of faith, but you've just, it's so much time has gone by. And you know, reason is the first enemy of hope. Time is the second. Because in the realm of the natural, the more time that goes by, the less likely the chances of a turnaround happening are. We all understand that. Science says if something happens 99 times the same way, it's going to happen the same way the 100th time. But the supernatural says it doesn't matter if it's happened the same way 999 times in a row, the 1,000th time could be completely different. Because God steps in, and when God steps in, everything changes. Luke chapter 5, Jesus said, go out and let down your nets. Peter said, we fished all night. We didn't catch anything. And Jesus said, just do what I tell you to do. Go out and put it on the right side of the boat. And boom, they started sinking 2 boats with the catch. They did it all night. Peter said, if we do it again, it's going to be the same result. They're just not biting. I don't know where the fish are. They're all hiding on the other side of the Sea of Galilee or something. They're not here, Lord. Just said, no, they'll be wherever I tell them to be. So Abraham's 99 years old. It's happened the same way for 99 years straight. Nothing has happened. And then all of a sudden, the 100th year is totally different. Here comes the promise. That's why you can't give up hope. But time goes along, and time wears down natural hope. But time actually builds hope in the spirit, because it just convinces you that you're that much closer to the breakthrough. So it says, I've already waited this long. It must be coming even sooner than I thought. That don't make any sense to the natural mind. But it makes perfect sense in the spirit. Now, Pastor Mark is a punctual guy. He likes to be on time. And we share that same, we were talking about it earlier. We like to be on time. But let's say Pastor Mark told me that he was going to pick me up for church tonight at 6 o'clock. Well, and I get ready and I go down to the foyer of the hotel and I'm waiting on him and he doesn't come. Well, at 6:05 comes, I think, well, he must have got caught in traffic. 6:10, 6:15, I think, well, something really happened. Must have been an accident on the interstate. 6:30, 7 o'clock comes around, I think, well, maybe I missed the time on the service. Maybe it was 7 o'clock. Maybe he told me 7 and I got confused and thought it was 6. Surely he'll be here at 7. No show. 7:30 comes around, I think, man, I don't know what happened. Maybe somebody got sick or had to go to the hospital. 8 o'clock comes, I think, hey, you know what? I don't know what's going on, but he's not coming. I go back up to the room. I put on my pajamas and turn on the NFL. And think, man, that was strange. I could have sworn there was a service tonight and I was supposed to speak at it. But I never got a call. I never got a text. I checked my phone. I checked email. I don't know what's going on. I just say, well, I guess by 9 o'clock, whatever was going to happen is too late anyway. I go to sleep. That's how we naturally deal with things. The longer time goes by, the more uncertainty there is, and then there even comes a certainty that it's not going to happen at a certain point. Well, if he shows up at the hotel at 10 o'clock, calls up to my room and says, I'm here. I'm going to say, well, you're too late. I'm asleep. Why? Because I was sure that by that time it's over. They're not going to have a service at 10 at night, and even if they are, I'm not going. But this is how we treat God. We set a timetable for God. God doesn't set the timetable. We set the timetable. We let God know, God, you've got this long. And then if God doesn't show up, we say, well, he might just be a little bit late. We'll just give him a little bit more time. And then if we're really spiritual, we'll give him a little bit more time. If not, we say, well, I got to take matters into my own hand. I've got to do something. If I don't do something, this is going. We get like Saul with Samuel. Samuel was late. We don't know why. Saul said, I got to go ahead and offer the sacrifice. And Samuel said to him, obedience is better than sacrifice. Isn't it funny how we get in the wrong seat and get in the driver's seat when God doesn't show up and start telling God when he needs to do what? He's God. He sees the whole picture from the beginning from the end. We see nothing but what we see, hear, and feel right this second. And yet we start giving the timetable to God. So here's how real hope works. If Pastor Mark says, I'm coming at 6 o'clock, he's not there. I think the same thing. Well, maybe he got caught in traffic. But by 9 o'clock, instead of being upstairs in bed watching the NFL, I'm so sure that he's about to come at any second, I don't dare leave the pickup area because I've been waiting 3 hours and I know he's about to come. And I'm not going to miss him. I'm not going to go up to the room and then he pull up and not see me and leave. Because I've been waiting 3 hours. And by 10 o'clock, I'm sitting out by the road. Because I know he's getting ready to come. That's how hope really works. The more time goes by, the more sure you become of what is going to happen. So it said, his faith never wavered. In fact, it grew stronger. So as time was going by, Abraham's like, oh, man, this miracle has been 20 years in the making. It's going to be a heck of a miracle. And he looking over there at Sarah, and he goes, oh, yeah, this is going to be a serious miracle. He's like, I'm looking old, and Sarah, you looking real old, girl. Jehovah is up to something big. Because if the two of us have a baby, they're going to be talking about this for 1,000 years. Wait, Abraham, it's actually 4,000. We're still talking about it. That's how hope works. And we have to understand that. You don't have to have a doctorate of divinity to understand not stopping to release your hope in the Lord. Even when there was no reason for hope and so much time had gone by, he just kept on hoping. You know, there's something about me, and I don't, it has to be, and many people would never want me to use grace in this way, but I'm going to use it in this way. There has to be a grace on me, in on my life, that keeps me from being able to die. It's a grace. It's the grace to bear the suffering and continue on. And when I was a teenager, and there was one time where I was very, very sick and was just very sick kid. I'd gone over to a friend's house, and while I was there, I began to feel very bad and told him I need to go home. Somewhere on the way home, it was 30 minutes from my parents' house, somewhere on the way home, I guess I blacked out. But I drove all the way home. And when I got to the house, I came in the house and was not even lucid, not even in my right mind. And laid down and then became unresponsive and went into a coma. Now, you can't tell me grace wasn't on me. I'm driving home 30 minutes away. I go into a semi-conscious state, and I drove all the way home. The angels of God were protecting me. And then I get home. I go into a coma. They rush me to the hospital. I've been in a coma for 3 days, Tuesday. And the whole time I'm coming in and out of this coma, I'm prophesying. In the critical care, the ICU, my dad was, they would only let him in every 4 hours. Serious ICU, I've got things hooked up all to me. He would bring a dictaphone in there, and I was prophesying. He recorded me prophesying, and later when I got out, he would play it back to me. And I had no recollection whatsoever of any of it. And by Tuesday night, there was a pastor friend in Baton Rouge named Dr. Malilly. He's on the board of ORU and very serious guy. I had a large church there. Was good friends with my dad. He went up to the hospital Tuesday night. He went home and told his wife. He said, Joel will be dead by the morning. He's right there. It'll be a miracle if he's still alive Wednesday morning. I lived. Not to take away the suspense again. I didn't die Tuesday night. By Friday, I was in a room. I came back in my right mind. By Sunday, they let me go. Tuesday, I was preaching again. I preached Tuesday night. I'd just get a chair and just sit in the chair and preach. Something in me just would not die. I could tell you those kind of stories for hours. Something in me just refused, even when I wasn't even in my right mind, something, my spirit refused to die. And that's the same something that has to keep hoping, even when your emotions and your mind, and have you ever said this before? I just can't handle it anymore. If I had a dollar for every time I said that, I could take everybody in here out to lunch at the most expensive place in San Diego and have $1 million left over. Because we make these big proclamations. I can't handle this anymore. But then we do. I've never said it one time where it was true. Never. I've said it so many times. I can't handle this anymore. I can't handle this more. But here I am. Here I am in San Diego preaching the gospel. I did handle it. That wasn't true. And our emotions get us to this place, and our emotions try to kick in and eclipse the sunlight of God's promise and make it look dark when the sun is still shining. So, well, everything's dark. Yeah, but the sun's shining. The facts are trying to eclipse the truth. And if we look hard enough, we can see the ring of truth. And know that it's still there. And if we'll just keep holding on, the moon will move out of the way eventually. And we'll be in the full, bright sunlight of the promise of God. The goodness of God. So you may have said, I can't take this anymore. I can't take the pressure of this. I can't take the weight of this. I can't take the waiting. I can't take this. I can't handle that. I don't know if I can go on. You can go on. Just keep hoping. Stay engaged with hope. And it doesn't matter whether you feel like you got faith or not. As long as you've got the lifeline of hope extended, faith is alive. When hope dies, the arm of faith is retracted and we lose our connection with God's supernatural source. And there's been a lot of times on the flip side of saying I can't handle it, there's been a lot of times where all I couldn't necessarily do all the things that we maybe say or do when we're in a place of great faith, and my faith would not have been considered great, but my hope was still alive, and therefore I was still in the game. I might have been injured. I might not have been able to perform at 100%, but at least I was still out there. When you lose hope, you leave the game, you go to the locker room, you're out of the game. You'll never score a touchdown in the locker room. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. You can only score if you're in the game. And hope keeps you in the game. It keeps you in the fight. You might got to knock down 10 times, but as long as you're still in the fight, you may land one lick and turn the whole thing around. And I'm here to tell you today, whether it's for today or whether it's for 10 years from now, when you get locked in a battle over a promise of God, because without a promise, it's just a wish. Hope is a wish when it's not rooted and grounded in the Word. You know, some people, God's like the genie in the sky, or he's like the lotto man. You just keep scratching away until you hit the winning number. No, that's not how God works. He's not a genie in the sky. We keep standing and believing and saying, God, my hope is in you. I don't care what the doctors say. I don't care what the bank account says. I don't care what the behavior of my son, daughter, parents, grandparents, niece, nephew, whoever it is you're believing God for. I don't care how I failed in the past in overcoming this addiction, this habit, whatever it is. I'm going to keep hoping. My hope is in you. And I know that at some point an Isaac is going to come. And Isaac means laughter. Because when God does what he promised he's going to do, it's going to be so ridiculous the way that he does it. All you can do is just laugh. All you can do is just sit back and laugh because it just overwhelms you with how ridiculous it is. When the Lord appeared at 99 and 89 to Abraham and Sarah in Genesis 18 and said, this time next year, you'll have a child, Abraham went, out loud. And the Lord said, why did Sarah laugh? And she said, oh, I didn't laugh. She said, no, you did laugh. No, you laughed. I heard you in there. I'm 89 years old. I'm not about to have any kid. But she was. She was. She did. I'm telling you, I'm looking for an Isaac. I'm looking for something to come along that when it happens, I go, man, you know what? I would have never signed up for that. But because I endured it and I came out on the other side, it brought great glory to God. My faith is renewed. It's ignited. It's excited. And people are going to come to the Lord because of what happens through my life. Where is your hope today? Is your hope alive? And you know what? You can't compartmentalize. You can't say, well, I've got hope for all these other things, this one thing. No. The measure of hope you have for the most difficult situation in your life is the measure of the hope that you have. You can't say, well, I've got great hope in these areas, but this one area here. No, that's the area where hope needs to come alive today. What's the area of your life that you say, I've given up on it? And, you know, religion says, well, that's my sacrifice before the Lord. No, it's not your sacrifice. It's your test. God didn't want Abraham to kill Isaac. He just was testing him. And your hope may be tested today. It may have been tested. You may be in a long battle like I've been in for 20 years, believing God. But you know what? I can't stop hoping now because I'm 20 years closer And I would be a fool to give up now after believing for 20 years. See, the world says cut your losses and move on. I say no. Stand on what you've already accomplished and know you're that much closer. This is the way that hope works. Let's bow our heads. Father, I just thank you today that you're using my story, my message, the message of hope, to ignite something in the hearts of believers and even those who may be here who don't believe, that you are the God of hope. You are the source of all hope. And I pray today, God, that you would fill our hearts so completely with that hope that Abraham had, that we would be men and women of faith that testify to the glory of God in such a way that the world would not be able to deny. Just as Abraham and Sarah at 100 years of age had a baby, they would not be able to deny the hand of the Lord. Lord, we thank you for what you're doing today. I want to do two things at least before I turn this back over to Pastor Mark. I want to pray for two groups of people. Tonight we're going to be praying, prophesying, moving in the Spirit, moving in the gifts. Tonight we're going to pray and ask the Lord for all nine gifts of the Spirit to be in operation. This has been happening, Pastor Mark, this has been happening in meetings in the last 3 months. I had 5 weeks in a row where we had a Sunday night revival service. And in all five services, the Lord said, ask me for all nine gifts. And I was in Jackson, Mississippi, and we articulated and were able to see all nine gifts of the Spirit in operation in one service. We're going to ask the same thing tonight. But right now, I want to pray. You may be here, first group. You may be here, and you don't really have hope because you don't know Jesus. And there is no hope outside of him. He is the source of hope. So if you don't have him, you don't have hope. You can try positive thinking. You can try all these kind of weird things that are out there now. But they don't work if you don't have Jesus. The second group I'm going to pray for when I get done praying for the first group is those of you who you need your hope to be energized, or you've lost hope in a situation and you want me to pray for you today that God would restore, renew, re-energize hope in your life for whatever situation it is that you're battling. It may be one, it may be five different things that you have need of hope in your life. You may have a lot of things going on that you need God to work in. And you need a big infusion of hope. We're going to pray for you today. But you're a believer, and God's going to do that work. But right now, first of all, I want to talk to you. You're not a believer. You came here today. You don't know Jesus, or you once did, and you've fallen away, fallen to the temptations of this world, fallen under the lure of the culture and the undercurrent, the undertow of iniquity that will drag you out into the sea of sin and away from the shores of redemption and righteousness. And today, the Holy Spirit is dealing with you. He is the agent of salvation. He brokers the deal, and he comes to convict of sin, convince of God's righteousness, found only in Jesus and the cross and the judgment that is to come upon all who reject God's righteousness found in Jesus alone and insist upon following the devil who's already been judged. That's what he does. That's his role to the unbeliever. And today you may feel that conviction of sin. You may know in your heart of hearts that you're not right with God. And if you stood before a holy God, you would be found wanting and lacking and with sin in your heart and not ready to meet him and rule and reign with him forever. Not having accepted the full ramifications of the blood of Jesus on the cross of Calvary, not having put your trust in him, and not having asked him to take his blood, the blood of the Lamb, and washed your life and cleansed your heart and given you newness of life, I tell you, there have been times where I have experienced the reality of the cross of Jesus so intensely that I could feel the spattering of the blood of the Lamb on my flesh and feel the heat, the 98.6 degrees of the heat of the blood of Jesus spattering on me and feeling the redemption and the cleansing of that blood upon my life. And I pray today that if you have not experienced that, you would experience the cleansing power. We're not talking about Clorox. We're talking about eternal stain removal, going from crimson to white as snow, supernaturally translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of righteousness. If that's you and you desire that today, right there, I want you to just lift up your hand and say, pray for me, wherever you are as I look around. If that's you, you need the Lord to do a work in your life. Is there anyone here today? There may be no one here today who needs that. But we're not going to walk out of here without making sure. Is there anyone today you say, pray for me? Just wave your hand at wherever you're at as I look around. That's right. This young man. Is there anyone else? I believe, yeah, right there. This precious lady. Young people, men, women. You know, men, we need to humble ourselves before God. Because the devil tells us you are God, and he's a liar and the father of lies. We need to humble ourselves before God. Thank you, Jesus. Now I'm going to ask everybody to just stand to your feet very reverently. You guys have been so wonderful today. Thank you for being so respectful of the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. Now if you lifted your hand or you didn't and wish you would have, I'm going to ask you to take another step of faith and slip past your neighbor and come and stand right here with me. I want to pray with you and pray over you today and believe God with you that the journey of faith begins today and your walk of victory and entering into the call and destiny of God begins today. If that's you, I want you to just slip past your neighbor in the aisle and come and just stand right here with me. This precious young man, that's right. Just right here. Just stand right here. This precious lady right here in the back. This precious young man, just right here, right here. Whoever you are, wherever you are, just make your move right now. This young man, just come and stand right here next to these other two young people. Is there anyone else? This precious lady. This precious little girl. Her whole life can be changed because of what God's doing today. Hope. Her name is Hope. Jesus. That's a confirmation today from the Holy Spirit. Not just of this message, but of his call and his plan on this young lady's life. And who are you? Are you the mother? Grandmother. You're the father. You're the father of hope. Huh. Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Boy, God is answering your prayers today, Mama. Woo, man. The Lord says, through this young lady, every regret, every disappointment is going to be reversed. And God is doing a new thing, even today, even now. And the Lord says, the glory of the latter house will be greater than the former. That which he will do in the rest of your life will so far eclipse everything that's happened up till now that you will look back and marvel at the goodness of God. Whew. Jesus, praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. It's okay. Jesus is just touching Mama. He's touching her. You're so beautiful. I want you, even you, Hope, put your hand over your heart. Dad, these two, just put your hand over your heart. And I'm going to lead you in a prayer. I want everybody to repeat with them. I want you to just say out of your mouth, out loud, say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Make me a new person. Give me a new heart with new and right desires. I don't have to try. I yield to your finished work on the cross of Calvary. You shed your blood, every last drop for me. For my mistakes, for my sins, to pay my debt, a debt I could not pay. You paid in full just for me. And I thank you, Father, for sending Jesus to take my place and reconcile my heart to your heart forever and ever. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Man, God is just, he's touching you and something real is happening in you. God's got a powerful call on your life, young lady. Baby, would you come up here? I want you to pray over this young lady. My wife has a strong anointing for young leaders, and the Lord's just showing me that you're going to go back across the ocean with the gospel of Jesus and be used in signs and wonders. You're going to preach the gospel. And I see right now there will be divine visitations as you seek the Lord and fast and pray. You will see the Lord and have sovereign visitations of God that will lead to many lives being changed in a great legacy eternally. And what's your name, Daddy? Antonio. Father, I thank you today. Antonio is going to become the father, the son, the husband that you've called him to be. I break every generational curse. I break every lie of the enemy. I break every bondage, every habit, every addiction. And Lord, I speak the law of life in Christ Jesus, the liberty of the Holy Ghost over his life even now. God, sanctify him from the top of his head to the soles of his feet. Let him never stray. Let him never look back. Let him never look to the left or the right, but focus on you as the author and the finisher of his faith every day, every day, every day. Until he is apprehended for that which you have apprehended him for. To do the will of the Father of his life. We declare it. We speak words of blessing over you, Antonio. Today, I want to declare the blessing of God over your life. Every negative word, every negative expectation is broken and canceled today. And now I speak blessing over you and expectations of godliness, expectations of going above and beyond what anyone has ever thought, spoken, or believed about you. We believe it today over you, and we release you to succeed in the kingdom. Father, I thank you. You're giving. What's your name?
Joshua.
Oh, Joshua. He. I thank you're giving Joshua the spirit of a conqueror. I thank you, Lord. Yeah. The Lord's going to give you a hunger for the Word of God. Well, you're going to begin to read the Word every day. It's going to be like you never read it before. You're going to get a good translation that you can understand easily, and you're going to begin to devour the Word, and it's going to get in you, and you're not going to be shaken. You're not going to be blown to and fro like a reed. You're going to stand like a mighty oak tree in the face of the storm, against the storm, and be on the solid rock with roots going down deep into the soil of God's love. And you're going to become a pillar in this house and in this community, a pillar of righteousness. You're going to stand up in your school. You're going to stand up in your neighborhood. You're going to stand up and be counted for righteousness' sake, no longer being pushed about by every wind that blows around, by the pressures of this world, but standing firm on the rock of your salvation. And Lord, I pray you just give him an anointing of John the Baptist. Jesus said, who did you go out there to see? A reed blown to and fro? No, no. Father, I just thank you that Joshua will stand with the sword of the Spirit in his hand, with the shield of faith, and be counted as righteous, and be salt and light. No more wavering between two opinions. Solidified in who you have called him to be. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Now, Hope, give me your hand, sweetheart. Father, I just speak a blessing over Hope. I claim every purpose of God will be fulfilled. God, raise her up as a prophetess in her own generation. Put your word in her mouth. Let her speak the word of God with boldness and clarity and power. Keep her in purity all the days of her life. Let her meet the right man, marry the right man. Let him be in love and have godly children and seed that bless your name. Let grandma live to see great-grandchildren that serve you and preach the gospel, and let her be endowed with great joy over what you've done. I bless you, Hope, in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
In Jesus' name.
Yes.
In Jesus' name. Now, I want to do something. I normally bring books with me because I like people to get my story, but I'm out and I'm waiting on another shipment. So I had two that I brought with me. One's in English and one is in Spanish. And I want to give this Spanish book to my sister over here. You speak Spanish? Yes, sí, señor. Lord told me to give this to you when I was preaching. He said, this is for you. I asked the Lord, I said, Lord, show me who. In fact, I was going to bring two books in English. The Lord said, no, one in Spanish, one in English. He knew what you were going through and what you've been going through even when I brought this. Who else would like this other copy of my book? I'm going to give it out right here. Yeah, I like you. I like you. What's your name?
Paul.
Paul. Oh, good godly name right there. Father, I just thank you. You're blessing Paul. I thank you, Lord, his best days are ahead. Every lie of the enemy that would say you're done, you're finished, there's no more that you have to give, it's broken, it's a lie, and you're going to preach the gospel on the streets and the highways and the byways. You're going to lay hands on the sick and they're going to recover. You're going to be like Paul, who went around and when he saw faith, perceived faith to be healed, he said, rise up, stand and walk. And Lord, today I just thank you that you're using this man and this woman for your glory. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give Jesus a hand clap. Thank you, Father. We glorify your name, Jesus. Glory, 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 glory. Tonight, we'll be back here at 6 o'clock, moving in the Spirit. We're just going to jump right off tonight into it and let the Holy Ghost do what he wants to do. We'll be prophesying, moving in the gifts. There'll be healings. Come tonight expecting. If you know someone else that needs to be in the meeting, bring them with you tonight. God's going to be doing things. One of the things that's going to happen that's been happening in all our meetings is an anointing for business, an entrepreneurial anointing, particularly with women who God has put a dream for business, or you failed in business, but you feel like there's still something there. Tonight, there's going to be an anointing released for entrepreneurial business. Many of you, God wants you to own your own business. You've not been able to break into that. Something is going to be broken tonight and released prophetically for that. So come prepared, ready for that in Jesus' name. Pastor Mark.
Yeah.
I turn it back over to you.
Yeah. Joel, that was awesome, man. We're so blessed. Listen, right here is an example of waxing valiant in fight. So many people don't understand the beauty of taking up the shield of faith to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. It's almost as though we've just relegated it to the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. When there's far bigger things to be going on in our lives, far bigger ventures, far bigger opportunities that Father has you and I to step into. However, every time we begin to move out in the realms of his word, there's an opposition that we're going to face.
Yeah.
And the Lord's called us to be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. You know, I was with Joel not too long ago, and I said, Father, I'll give Joel a kidney. And Father said, you don't need to. I'm going to give him a kidney. Yeah. Dad, I want you to think about this with me, dear people, because I am just so blessed to watch this life that will not let up. Joel, if somebody dies, Joel's going to be over there to raise them from the dead. He's not thinking, oh, you know, I'm still waiting to deal with my own problem or whatever, you know, or set back because of circumstance or situation. He's not letting experience dictate to him what it is he's going to believe. But the word of God has preeminence to rule over his life and to rule over his soul and his actions and his deeds. You know, I've been reveling in this word of the Lord where this woman cried out. She began to worship Jesus and she said, blessed be the paps that gave you nourishment. Jesus said, no, blessed is he who hears my word and keeps it, guards it, watches over it, protects it, because there is a violent attack against it. Now listen, people, I want to give you an opportunity to worship the Lord. I mean, I want it to be worship. I am a worship guy. I love worship. I am pressing in for a realm of worship beyond anything that I've known in my life. And I want you to come along with me. And when we begin to worship the Lord with our finances, let me just say this. It is something that needs to be all about Jesus. It needs to be all about the context of the church, all about the context of what it is He's purposed for us to do. He's told us to take care of the orphans. He's told us to take care of the widows. He's told us to take care of the poor. He's told us to take care of traveling ministry. And He told us to take care of the house, the church, the things of the church, the local church. Now listen, if that's what Father has asked of us, then my, He's going to really resource us, because that's a whole lot. That's a whole lot of giving. That is a whole lot of responsibility upon our shoulders to participate in what He wants to do to bless all of the nations of the earth. I want you to let your seed, the seed of the finances that you have, be something that Father can bless all the nations of the earth through you. The smallest acts of obedience, I started off with this, I'm going to end with it. The smallest acts of obedience create the greatest miracles of faith. I want to say this, listen to me. God said to Jacob, this is what I'm going to do for you. Jacob responded, seeing as you're going to do this for me, I don't want to forget. Really, this is what he's saying. Seeing as you're going to do this for me, I'm going to honor you with a tithe of everything, a tenth of everything that you give me. I want you today, we're going to receive an offering for Joel and Amy tonight, because I want to be a part of their ministry in a greater way. I want to give you the opportunity to do so as well. But right now, we're going to give you an opportunity also to participate with God in a miraculous thing. First and foremost, where we personally, individually get to honor Father for all that He's done and all that He's blessed us with. We honor Him with our substance and with the first fruits of all of our increase. And there is a miraculous multiplication, provision that Father has commanded towards us. He's placed it on us. And if you've got a heart and a desire to do what Father has commissioned us to go to do, and that is to preach the gospel in all of the nations of the earth, we have to do it. We have to be a part of it. Listen, then we're going to have to understand how to step into a greater dimension and provision. I was telling Joel that as soon as I got back from Nepal, when we did the crusade there in 2008, the Lord immediately laid upon me Kyrgyzstan. And I was just on a run for the nations right then. And everything that we had, everything that could possibly come against us happened. The people who had finances in the church that could have really helped, they left. They got offended and they left. I mean, it was just one thing after another. We battle these things. Ultimately, we know what God will do through our lives if we're willing to sow everything that we are into the kingdom. He'll raise up something that goes way beyond anything we could ever be and reveal His Son in you and me. Amen. This is true. This is true. So as you step out today, believe that God's going to multiply in every way, and He's going to bless you not only in your health, not only in your physical body, but He's going to bless you in every dimension of those realms of the anointing. So you'll prosper and be in health in direct proportion to that spiritual increase in your life. Amen. So come worship the Lord with your giving. Also, find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' name. Amen.